develop in the future and address it very effectively. So please make sure that you are going to anticipate something about what the child is going to have in the future and address it so that the child doesn't go to the secondary impairment stage. Now, this is another factor which I thought it will be interesting to share here. So there are the max abilities which usually which usually the child develops during early stages, like, you know, around 0 to 5 years, the child develops this, which are very good for the max abilities later. Okay, the working memory, executive function, attentional control, the perceptual and visual spatial skills, all these are very good for the child to develop the math abilities later. So if the child is having some kind of a problem in math abilities later, probably these are the areas which were not worked initially during the early intervention stage. So as a therapist, you need to be focusing on all these aspects as a holistic therapist. So please remember, these are the things which are affected or impaired in preterm babies. Most of you have done Preschool GM would be knowing about this, because that they give about what are the things which you can expect this child would be, you know, getting affected in the future. They would give you a clear map about it. Okay. So this is another study which I thought would be very interesting to share. After adjustment for IQ, studies have repeatedly highlighted the persistent problem with max and oral motor skills, verbal working memory, perceptual motor and visual spatial organizational difficulties. So motor development plays a very important role in the cognitive and perceptual skills. So if the child is delayed in motor wise, the child might have some delay in the cognitive and the perceptual skills wise as well. So make sure that you jump in and help the child understand the body better so that the child can also have the other abilities coming in. As a physiotherapist, it's our responsibility, and as an early interventionist, so that we can contribute for the same in a very appropriate manner, we can do. There is another study which shows that infants who received early intervention that attended specifically to self-regulation and parent-infant interactions had a better outcome at 2 years of age. Okay, so infants who had so that is why it is always important to have the mother or the primary caregiver be part of your program of early intervention. Most of the clinics act like, you know, they are like kindergartens or nursery, where the mother drops the child and the mother can go and she can do whatever work and she can come and pick up the child. So this is not going to work, because you need to make sure the mother is an active partner in the key aspects of rehabilitation, particularly in early intervention. So making sure that this parent-infant interaction, you have a study which shows that this has significant better outcome, motor outcome in children under 2 years. So this is the base where the child will show better motor outcome later. So please look into it. If you are following a principle where, like, you know, the parent is made to wait outside and you are treating a child inside the clinical room, it is not going to help. So make sure the mother is involved, the primary caregiver is involved. I am trying to address again and again, mother does not mean that I have something against the fathers. What I am trying to say is, usually in the given scenarios, mothers are the primary caregivers who always accompany. Even here, mothers are always the primary caregivers. And this is the term which you will be looking at, something called anticipatory guidance, which is very important. Those who have done GM, you would be knowing what is anticipatory guidance. And this is people who have done NBA, people who have done Brazeltons might also know what is anticipatory guidance, because this is very important to promote the confident parenting and overall family functioning. So you need to do an anticipatory guidance where you are guiding the primary caregiver or the mother in the future, what will be the challenges the child might be having and how effectively you can address those. So you provide the information to parents with the expected outcome, and so that it brings a change in the parents' attitude, knowledge or behavior. And according to Brazelton, anticipatory guidance is a mechanism of strengthening the child's potential. So you see how two different viewpoints are. Okay, Telzro says that it is information which is given to parents so that the expected outcome will be a change in the parents' attitude, knowledge or behavior. Whereas Brazelton says that it is the mechanism where you share all those, but it actually strengthens the child's potential. So please remember this. So when you are treating a child, always you have to anticipate certain things and you have to guide the parent. That is part of the anticipatory guidance, which is very important aspect of early intervention. Holistic is what you have to be. Early intervention needs to be holistic, and that should work on cognitive abilities and play. So as a therapist, you need to work on all the 10 which is listed here. Communication, you also should be working on fine motor, gross motor areas, social and emotional development, attention and concentration, self-regulatory skills, general movements, behavior, and muscle tone. So your goals need to be smart. Okay. So I don't care whether you are looking smart or not. Your goals need to be smart. So your goals should have a sensory component. It should have a motor component. It should have an attention component. It should have a self-regulation component. And finally comes your treatment strategies. That's what I mean by SMART. S-M-A-R-T is where you have all these components to achieve your set goals. Taking into consideration all the aspects that can promote development and not isolating the only component like motor or sensory would help the child. And this becomes mandatory for an early interventionist. So what happens more or less is like, you know, sometimes I see PT saying, oh, that is a OT's job. It is not my job. Sometimes OT is saying that is a PT's job, not my job. No. Sometimes what happens is you need to be focusing on every aspect what the child will be having to make sure that it is a holistic view you have rather than just taking one component like it is a motor component, gross motor I'll be working. It is the sensory component which OT will be working. No, don't look into that way. So as an early interventionist and particularly as a PT, your role is quite vast and very important as you're going to set the process of the child's journey in exploring the world. So make sure your goal is holistic and ticks all the right boxes in development. Okay, here I've given some samples of assessments we do. With some of the children we have, I had the privilege to treat. I'm just showing some samples of it. This is the first child you see on the left side where the child is made to lie down in supine. We are trying to give some kind of an auditory input. We are trying to see whether the child is able to visually respond or not. So this child, when I was doing this, was around 14 months, I think. 14 months or so. 14 or 13 months when I was doing this. So it was just an assessment to look whether the child is able to interact with the kind of a sensory input what we are giving, interact with the environment. So this is what we were trying to do with that child there. And this is another assessment where you see that this is a little older child who is made to stand and give some kind of an activity to engage him. Okay. I'm just assessing how he can sustain the posture with balance, the amount of muscle work he's able to have, and the way he's reaching with bilateral hand act. You can see that he almost had a fall. So the assessment here is to understand what kind of muscle work and synergies he is using. Okay. So in this picture, on the left side and right side, most of the participants here who have whom I had an interaction with around 2004-2005, they might be knowing this because some of them are also sitting there. So this child had initial problem in sitting, and post the treatment session, you can see how he's sitting very good here. So this is what I said about a set session goal, where within one session, you can understand. So this child, as he was moving towards the therapist, I saw him how he is moving. And by the time when I looked at him, how he is moving, I listed out the group of muscles where he is having a problem with. So during my treatment session, I was addressing that. And at the end of that, you can see how he is sitting on his ischial tuberosity. Here you can see that he is struggling to even hold sitting where he is almost putting his weight on his sacrum. His both the knees are up. In fact, he's taking his hands help to hold on to his knees so that he's trying to sustain in sitting. But here you can see that he has a very straight back, putting the weight on his ischial tuberosity, and both his hands and his knees are down on the floor. So this picture is one of my favorite pictures which I show in most of my workshops, because the reason is I have plenty of treatment sessions where I have done, I have met my session goals. I have treatments where the sessions were taking so long and finally we did the session goal. Some of my treatment sessions where, you know, I was not able to achieve my session goal. I came very close to it, but I couldn't achieve the session goal. So a session goal is something which you need to be passionate about and you keep setting. Do not matter whether you are working with the child for half an hour, 45 minutes or 1 hour or 2 hours. It doesn't matter. Please understand, even if you're working for this amount of limited time given, because most of you will be working in some setups where you will be seeing back-to-back kids, like 10 kids in a day, where you might be giving half an hour sessions for every of one of them. Even in that half an hour session, you try to look in a component which you can put in and try to show the change. So the next is another assessment of another child whom I had a privilege of treating. So this is the video of that child. So I'm doing an assessment here where he's sitting in side sitting and I'm giving a unilateral reach and throw activity. So I'm trying to understand what all the muscle group he's able to do and how good he can sustain the posture and whether he is able to actively involve himself in play. See, I'm not trying to distract him. I'm actually involving him in the play. I have a play partner sitting opposite to him who throws the ball to him and he's playing with him. So I'm trying to work on, I'm trying to make an assessment of what he is trying to do with this kind of a postural pattern and what are all the muscles which are working and what are the muscles which are not working. So assessments can be, it's not that you put a child only in supine and do an assessment and then put a child in prone. No. If the child can move, make the child move. If the child can sit, make the child sit. Do an assessment, because assessment, I believe, is an ongoing process. So you cannot do an assessment on the first day itself. Sometimes it's an ongoing process. You do the assessment on first day, then start working on the base, whatever you have. And the second day, you get some idea about the child. And third day, you get a complete picture about the child. So keep going on. It's an assessment is an ongoing process, which helps you to understand the problems the child is having. At the same time, assessment can also help you whether your treatment strategies are working or not. So please understand that. So that is what I'm trying to share here. And thank you so much for your patience. This final video is of another child who had a privilege of treating. After a couple of sessions and a longer duration of sessions, you can see this child now taking some steps and walking. This is the first time he's initiating that walk. You can see that now he's standing on his own. So this is happening within one session. What I'm trying to say is even in one session, you can do wonders if you keep working on the focus of your... I'm not saying always you will be successful. What I'm trying to say is you need to have the understanding that you might fail, you might fall, but still you should have the understanding, you should be able to pick it up and work on it again and again so that finally the child is having the ability to reach the set goal which you have put for this time. Okay. Thank you for your patience. With this, I would be concluding my presentation and hopefully my lecture was clear. If you have any questions, I would be happy to answer.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot for such a great deliberation on a much needed topic. And we had actually enjoyed a very good practical session today on the early intervention and its importance. And really, I think I have never attended the session where really the multidisciplinary approach and so much of the clear explanation on the topic I have ever heard. So this was, I think, for my, it was a first lecture when I have learned such a great way about the early intervention and the intervention in the children with a special need. So really thankful to you, sir. And with your kind permission, I would like to request all the participants, if anyone has any query, they can please ask.
Thank you. Thank you so much for your kind words, Mr. Himanshu.
So we are receiving the great feedback in the chat box, sir, and it was really... means I don't have the word to express my gratitude and word to express my pleasure. And this was really an outstanding and wonderful session, sir. And really,
no, not at all. It's a pleasure from my side as well. Thank you for giving this opportunity to interact. Yes. In Corona time, it's very difficult to even interact with your own children and wife. And you have given me an opportunity to interact with so many people. Yes, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Any questions, please? I'm open for questions. Any questions, please, you can ask me. I'll be happy to attend to. But my suggestion would be, if you are a therapist in pediatrics, if you are a therapist in early intervention, try to learn this assessment scales, which I said about general movement, Bailey's and Hammersmith, which will be very useful for you so that you can understand the child better and address the issues.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. And yeah, there's a question from Pritam Haldar. So
yeah, can you kindly tell something about, I know I have just went, where is it? I'm not able to see. Yes. Okay. Can you kindly tell something about delayed milestones and these treatment procedures can be used in which all cases besides CPE? Okay. See, today's webinar was more about cerebral palsy. Okay. So cerebral palsy, by definition, that's why I said there is some understanding you should have about neuronal plasticity, neuronal group selection theory, what is plasticity, how it can be addressed. So when you are talking about cerebral palsy, when you're talking about children who have cerebral palsy, they are obviously going to have some kind of a problem in their milestones. So when you are saying that, can you tell something about delayed milestones? Most of my lecture covered it. Like if it's a child with ataxic cerebral palsy, what will be? If it's a child with athetoid, what will be the primary problem? Like that. So most of it I covered. So delayed milestones is a general global developmental delay. It's a general terminology used for anything which is not being achieved within the time frame given. So that is a delayed milestone. Okay. So so in cerebral palsy, you see delayed milestones. And you see even in SMA delayed milestones, you see in muscular dystrophy, some kind of a regression. If it is an onset earlier, it is a delay. If it is a later onset, like after 5 years, it's a regression of whatever the abilities the child achieve. So delayed milestone is a very a broad terminology. And that is what it is all about. So what are the, these are techniques which are specifically, I'm talking about cerebral palsy. So that's what I'm saying. So you need to have to equip yourself before you apply this to the children whom you are attending to. So do the courses, do the assessment, programs which will help you to understand the conditions better so that your treatment strategies are very effective. Okay. So I hope I have answered you. The next question is from Sarah. How can you manage the involuntary movements in dystonic CP? And as it will interrupt the, of course, dystonic CP is one big challenge. So just find out the keys which you can address, because I cannot say a general statement like, for dystonic CP, you do this. And then I'm guiding you wrong. What I'm trying to say is find out the component which actually triggers this dystonia and how effectively you have done. One of the common strategies I have used in my experience for dystonic CP is that I form an excellent rapport with the child. Once a child trusts me, the dystonic reactions automatically goes down. So one of the things I have learned from my experience, but it not applies to everybody who's working. So if you develop a trust, because relationship is all about trust. So if the child trusts you, the child is not going to throw in dystonia in a defensive mode. So make sure that you establish that fantastic rapport with the child so that the dystonic feature comes. This is only a small suggestion I'm saying. There are plenty of things you can do with dystonia. Okay, I'm not going to give you all those in detail. I'm just giving you one idea about it. Okay. Okay. The other question is, if the child achieves all milestones but not making eye contact, then what could be the reason? Now, this is a very general statement. It is very difficult to understand what you're trying to say. If the child achieves all the milestones but not making eye contact, please do not jump into conclusion and label the child as something else. So what I'm saying is, give some thought about it. Look into all the ways of addressing this. And find out all the facts behind this process of no eye contact. So before that, please don't jump into it and conclude something as, okay, this child is not giving eye contact. Okay, this will be this child. But what you are trying to imply is like the child is normal in development, but still not having eye contact. Maybe this child might be having a pervasive developmental disorder. That is what you are trying to suggest. So maybe this child might be having an autistic presentation. What I'm trying to say is there are a lot of maybes and a lot of ifs and buts. So what I'm saying is this is a very general line of statement. So you need to look into all those things of assessment before concluding that, yes, this child have this kind of an issue and this will be the treatment strategy. Okay. I hope I have answered you.
Thanks a lot, sir, for great deliberation and for answering all the queries. We are really much indebted to you for such a great explanation and
thank you so
a great
much.
Lecture
thank you.
With us. And we are really privileged to have numerous, even senior physiotherapists also joins us. And we are thankful to all the senior academicians, physios who joins us around the globe. And we are privileged to have Dr. Amita Anup Sharma ma'am with us. She's joining us from the Saudi Arabia itself. And Dr. Nanda Kumari, she's also joining us from Malaysia. And she's also a clinical physical therapist there. And Dr. Sunita Sharma ma'am, she's professor in the Jaipur Hospital College of Physical Therapy and working as a principal in charge here. And a few other, I think, senior physical therapist, my own teacher and mentor, Dr. Harsh Rajdeep, sir. We are really blessed that they are always continuously supporting and blessing us for the effort of just sharing the knowledge among the participant. And all these things are possible just because of the great person and great personalities like you, sir, that they are giving you their precious time and selflessly and without any without in their personal benefit, you are giving their time, your knowledge sharing. So we are really much much more grateful to you for your time sparing for us. And really, we learned a lot during this COVID pandemic. And by these efforts, I would say, yes, this COVID pandemic has become a learning pandemic for each and everyone. And yes, this has been possible because of the people like you, sir. Really, really must
thank you. Thank you. I see a lot of known names, known faces. I see some new names, new faces. And all the best to all of you. Thank you so much for sparing your time and attending this. Hopefully, we meet somewhere, sometime, I know, later again. Thank you so much. Thanks a lot.
Again,
thank you. Good night, people. Good night. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Thank you. Bye.